Thank you, Sara. It's really nice to be back alive. And I also appreciate being the first speaker. I woke up this morning 2:30 a.m. UK time. So, but don't worry, I won't really go to sleep because the data is so damn exciting. And when I go to that, I will obviously show some forward-looking statements, and this is really to disclaim those away. We have three targets. They all target our immune system. And by far, you may realize that if our immune system is not active enough, we run into a problem. COVID-19 is such a good example of that. We are trying to protect those people who, for some or the other reason, have weakened immune system, and then we need to isolate them and make sure that they get vaccinated. That's the way how we have acquired immunity. It means that you activate the immune system. We use that and you can have an infection and the same system really protect you for quite a number of years if the same antigen material, bacteria, virus will come and enter your body. Then we have a maintenance system called innate immunity. That controls and patrols in you all the time. Even you are sitting here, sleeping in the bed, that keeps us aware of something goes wrong, and they try to clean it. And one way they clean it is to eat out that material that is dangerous to you. Now the key problem here is that why these do not recognize the tumor, the cancer cells, as a dangerous signal in us and let them to grow. So something goes wrong. And we need to understand that something goes wrong before we can fix that. We have three targets in here. In the middle of the immuno-oncology target, I'm spending most of my time on this bexmarilimab. We call it bex because it's easier, but the bexmarilimab is the official in name and we have to use it. But we do continue the work with the recombinant interferon beta called Romakine program. I'm not going to talk too much about that, but we hope to be able to tell more to all of you later this year. And then we have this way of increase the stem cells that produce these defense cells. Those are the hematopoietic stem cells, usually born from the bone marrow, and for that reason, they have to be controlled, and we have a way to do it. And obviously, without them, we would again have a problem that there won't be defense cells. So three very interesting targets, really doing a pharmaceutical development to get drugs for us, and then help us in rather significant disease conditions. The anti-clever antibody, clever is the target molecule which we would like to shut off because that is behind these immune suppressive activities tumor would like to use to their own benefit. The market is really significant. The one part of these immune activators, the PD-1 blockade, is already selling roughly 30 billion, but it's only targeting one immune target. Activating the T cells. That's only one cell type of our immune system. Don't believe that it's going to take care of everything. We need to do something else. And the reason is very obvious. If you use PD-1 blockade, it only reaches maybe 15 to 20% of the cancer patients with the effective way. So we are missing something here, and that something has to be worked out in order to maximize the efficacy of that product, but also other products which probably are still to be discovered. So we believe that bexmarilimab blocking the clever function, activating the myeloid cells that are the maintenance cells, activate the immune system, we can activate also the T cells to the maximal potential when PD-1 blockade is used in cancer patients. The slide is pretty much complex, but it tells everything. It's pretty colored, at least. We have T cell around the cancer cells, but sometimes they do not recognize them. Those are the bystander cells, so they have to be activated. And even you activate the existing T cells, if they do not recognize the cancer cells, they won't help. So you need another cell type that activates the microenvironment, and that's what the target anti-clever antibody is doing for those myeloid cells. Now, we have been carrying out Matin's trial, That is early phase one, phase two trial, but it is already a significant population of the cancer patients. These patients are what we call last line patients. They have gone through at least 3 to 4 previous treatments, including chemotherapy and also the recent immune therapies. So they are resistant to all of those, and that's the reason they have come to our trial. We have treated more than 200 patients. And we started with the dose escalation, as you may recall. We went to the different cancer cohorts, which are listed in here. We already know that we have some very promising results, and that will I show in a minute. And then we are still doing some optimal dosing, because we wanted to make sure that when we move on into the pivotal stages, the dosing is proper. And we have already announced that it's not that much different if you give the patients 1 mg/kg or 3 mg/kg or increase the frequency. It looks like once the immune activation has taken place, it stays on those patients. And this is a very critical understanding for us, because now we can really also build up the protocols when we move into bigger studies, obviously, in order to get marketing approval filed in within the future years. The bexmarilimab is really amazing cancer drug. It has not shown severe adverse events. Why is that? My best guess is that the same mechanism is in use in the physiological settings. One best example is pregnancy. These same cells, which now in the cancer patient immune suppress the immunity and hide the tumor, is used during the pregnancy to hide the embryo. And that is the reason why these same cells migrate to placenta. There is a tremendous number of them in the placenta. It keeps, these cells keep mother's immune host system separate from the embryo so that the embryo would not be resected. Mothers are okay. Same happens now in the cancer patients. Even we knock out the clever one, nothing serious seems to be happening. And we know that the healthy tissues do not recognize bexmarilimab at all. So that's the reason why we probably have this really good safety profile. This is a valuable information because now when we go to the combinations, we do not add any risk on the safety side. The immune combinations, especially anti-PD-1 and anti-CTL4, sorry for these symbols, is causing severe adverse events, so that actually restricts their combined use. We may not have the situation in our case, which is really extremely good. We do have some autoimmune reactions, which is really nice because it's actually demonstrating that we are activating the immune system. But those have been possible to treat having a break in the administration or then using steroids to slow down the immune reaction. So very promising safety profile, unlike many other ones. Then we notice, and this is a real data, imaging data from the patients looking at the tumor size. That's what doctors want to see when they treat. What happens to the tumors? You can see that we stabilize many of them. In some of them, the size of the tumor is shrinking, meaning that it's disappearing. That it is exactly the purpose of these treatments. Just keep in mind that we are now looking at last-line patients who had no options anymore. They all had a progressive condition when they came to the trial. And when you look at how many of these different cohorts responded to the treatment, they are listed in here. We have all the way from close to 40% to zero. We have some really zero ones, unfortunately, pancreatic cancer, uveal melanoma, no response in this setting. But then we have some very promising ones, melanoma, cholangiocarcinoma, gastric adenocarcinoma, even hepatocellular carcinoma, and hormone-sensitive breast cancer. Obviously, very interesting really for us to move on. So if you now look at how these patients really survive, it is a remarkable difference to those who do not respond to the treatment. These are the ones who respond, and at this point, we are not even reached the medium survival. However, we announced that it's 4.9 months from starting the first bexmarilimab treatment. And the patients who do not respond, that's the blue curve, they have 4.4 months. So we have a roughly 3.5 times increased survival rate with the patients who get the reaction what we want to take place, and that is activate the innate immune system to generate the immunity against, hopefully, the cancer. Most important thing for us also, can we identify these patients so that we can actually enrich the population or identify them already in the first line setting? Now we are in the last line setting. And the answer is yes. And this we have also looked very thoroughly. We have looked some of the immune markers which are known to tell us if the immunity is on or off. And these are three of them, interferon gamma, TNF-alpha, and interleukin 6. And as you can see, the red representatives here, they have very low baseline in their circulation, telling that there's no immune activation in those, even they have maybe treated with the PD-1 blockades. Yes, we can now identify them, meaning that we can enrich, like I said earlier, or utilize this also in other settings. And this is really important. You have a new mode of action, you can identify the patients so that it's not shooting in the dark. And PD-1 blockade has very few, if only one immunohistological stain which actually can be used today really to predict if they are responsive or not. So very significant milestone again for us. We also wanted to look at the duration of this immune activation, and this is looking melanoma patients and some other ones, and you can see the responders, they have roughly 3-4 weeks activation of the immune system. That is definitely long enough to activate the immune system to provide long-lasting effect. These are the non-responders. Some melanoma patients indicated here, they have extremely potential gamma interferon increase, tenfold, maybe 20-fold, which is really remarkable. One single bexmarilimab treatment can cause this. So we really changed the profile of these patients. Now, what happens with the PD-1? They actually are successful in patients which have high interferon gamma expression, and that is shown in here. So if you have low interferon beta and you have a PD-1 treatment, those patients die. If you have interferon gamma up and you add PD-1, they survive. So it's completely opposite what we see in bexmarilimab. Just using common sense, think about what the combination could provide for these cancer patients. With the PD-1 blockade, you have a maximal stimulation of these T cells, which was the one set of those defense cells. They can really attack the cancer. They are needed in order to do that. But with the bexmarilimab, we can generate more of them from naive T cells so that we have a higher repertoire really to attack the cancer. And if you really look at this combination opportunity, it looks like we have really dream team here. PD-1 blockade and bexmarilimab. Well, obviously, this is what we would like to do, and that's the study we are hopefully be able to start soon. We are filing the protocol in by the end of the year. So this is now first line setting. The previous patients I showed are last line patients, and we are not sure how intact their immune system is. Obviously, we know that it's not intact. Just look in the profile of those immune cells. But here, when we go first in with the PD-1 blockade, which is already in standard of care, we are targeting head and neck, maybe some urothelial cancer, and then obviously lung cancer. This is the cascade, and once we have done this, then we can move on to the pivotal part. This is really a global study as well. We have really now more and more sites in the US side, and more people also over there. A lot of the activities are really going to take place in the future on the US sites. So that's COMPO. And this is now a schematic where we are. So Matins is pretty much now closing. We have the information what we wanted. There will be some additional data. Checkpoint combination, PEX combo, I just explained. That's our own. And we do have a collaboration with the San Antonio site in Texas who are initiating a PEX combo investigator-driven trial as well. But then we have one surprise for all of us, and that's PEX map. That's this one in here. Cancer is bad enemy. They utilize all the biological tools they can find in order to spread in us. But we need to prevent that. With the PEX map, these are myeloid cells which are born in the bone marrow. They start to proliferate too much in the bone marrow, then they take over our blood cells. If you have an acute myeloid leukemia, depending a little bit what states you get it and in what condition you are, your survival in 5 years' time is only 10%. A really bad condition. What is so interesting in this is really that these cells, you can see they are stained in here. The red color indicates that they are clever one positive. So now we have this immune suppressive clever one molecule on the surface of these cancer cells. It's like they are carrying their own immune suppressant when they go into circulation and keep out the T cells. Don't come to bug me. I want to, you know, live in this nice person. Go away. Now, what we want to do is to knock out these. And there is indication in the literature already that this is really correlating. If there is an abundance of clever one, first outcome you have, indicating that we may really be. And we have already now in ex vivo setting tested that, and it really looks be the case. So this trial is ongoing. We started with a standard of care where the patients have been resistant to the first standard of care compound, azacitidine. That is a chemo treatment. Now there is also a new one where that is combined with the venetoclax. It's a BCL2 inhibitor, very toxic one, but it's practically the only drugs we have for these patients at the moment. So this is ongoing, first cohort already recruited. We start to get results, hopefully this year, and then move on to this triple combination. Extremely interesting trial, and results will be rather soon, and being so aggressive indication, we just believe that this could be a really fast way to the market as well, because there's no really good treatment for this condition. So, new mode of action, activating innate immunity in order to generate a new T cells to the system that actually could recognize the T cells, and that effect can maximally be activated with the combination with PD-1 blockade. Absolutely well tolerated, and as I described, we are going to move on really using the biomarkers, and we have been really setting also those development along these clinical development, what we do at the moment. We are not doing alone this. These are board of directors. One of the recent member, Eric, lives in Boston, who has as a CFO of other biotech companies, taking companies to the NASDAQ. Don't ask when we do it, but obviously, remember sentence, young men go west, young men go west, so we have to go west. That's from our perspective. We have also increasing number of people on the US side looking after the clinical trials and also in investor relationships. And not forgetting the background people, two key scientists who really help us to understand the whole mode of action and explain what's really going on with the patients and with really good number of advisors. I interviewed recently Jonathan Knowles. He was Roche's R&D director for more than 12 years. He was a chairman for ImmuneCore and board member for Genentech also for a number of years. In that interview, Jonathan actually mentioned that PEX could be even higher upside than PD-1 blockades, but that's his opinion. But I like that a lot, I have to say. And then we have program-specific advisors who are really helping us when we build the programs, protocols, and setting up the sites. So I think really want to just thank you for those who have been supporting over the years. Now it's really coming to the point that we can start to collect all the fruits we have been farming for the last, you know, 5-6 years.
Markku, that's quite, it's quite moving, really. So in all the presentations I've seen you deliver over the past few years, I've never seen so many faces who are like the who's who in biotech and pharma. So congratulations. Also congratulations on the surprise, the BexMab surprise, which makes me wonder why the share price isn't reflecting the surprise and the glory, glorious juiciness of all these faces we're seeing. So £97 million market cap, it has been higher. So I could give you an easy out, which is it's just the market, other companies' share prices look the same, sentiment, or is it because the investors, the market, are wondering about funding and getting this surprise into market?
I totally share that worry, because I'm worrying that as well, as you may believe. But we are dealing with a new mode of action. And a lot of people are asking, are you the only one who are targeting this molecule? And I said that, yeah, that's the purpose, because we have extremely good patent protection for this target molecule. We have a global patent approved in all the major pharmaceutical markets, and that will last to 2037 today. We can make some tricks even to extend that even further. Now we are 22. Very few pharmaceutical compounds have that patent protection this close to the market. Then to sell the new mode of action, people may have difficulties to kind of get the point, and I'm trying to now make it as much as we can. With me is our new head of the comms over there, Jennifer, who probably will write some interesting stories for us to really make people to understand that PD-1 has been exciting, but it's not everything. And PD-1 blockade has to be combined also. And people have now made random combinations. We are looking at the science, and we now understand why this combination could be really dramatic help to these cancer patients.
But what about the funding? So you obviously would like more money.
No, well, you saw that we have an IR head based in New York. So you can read that, yeah, something is going on. I can't say more than that at the moment.
NASDAQ listing?
It's very obvious for many of the European biotechs, and that actually could fix the market cap, what we have at the moment.
Okay.
I take it really seriously, because okay. I don't like the market cap either, what we have.
Markku, that's very interesting to hear your progress in the last 2.5 years. I think that was the last time I saw your presentation. For your PD-1 blocker and BEX combination study, are you going to use just one PD-1 blocker, something like Keytruda, or are you going to use a range?
That's a very good point. I start saying that I have asked so many clinicians and experts, are the PD-1 inhibitors all the same, or are they different? Mm. And current understanding is that they are pretty much the same. They may have some delicate differences, but practically they target the same immunological synapsis molecule, and obviously then the outcome should be the same. When we go to the standard of care, then it includes already PD-1 in that cancer type. Mm. And we would like to utilize that setting, because then we don't need to cover the cost of that, which is really significant if you would like to buy Keytruda, for example, from Merck. Yeah. So, and all those I listed over there, head and neck and urothelial and lung, they already have the PD-1 that is approved. Yeah. So then we utilize the first line setting, put just specs on top of it.
Okay, can I ask another one? You were talking about the patent protection going out to 2037.
Correct.
Is that just for antibodies, or is that for small molecules as well?
It's for the antibody and the receptor, both sides. The recognition of the antibody to the Clever One binding site. So it's really the antibody.
So it covers small molecules which could be incorporated into pills?
I can't answer that how well it actually covers that, but definitely will keep out all the biosimilar antibodies from the market to that point.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Uwe Iltapäivä.
Uwe Iltapäivä.
Stephen Martin from Clavis Capital. I have a question. Have you looked at combination with radiation therapies, in particular proton therapies, because you're making a lot of progress in those areas?
That's a good point. I'm not excluding radiation away, because we know that radiation will kill the cancer cells and produce a lot of a tumor material. And if you then have an immune activation around at the same time, that material will be introduced to our immune system, and by that way you can actually generate cancer antigens to be immunized to your whole system. So we have been thinking really that, and one example is obviously glioblastoma, which practically, if you can really surgically remove the tumor, radiation is practically the only one you can really use. And at the same time, if you can now activate the immune system, you may have actually success rate much higher than just the radiation alone. Yep, we just can't get there yet, but getting there one day.
So I'm going to be indiscreet. I know that you've had 4 meetings today. You were up at half past...
This has been the most exciting one.
Oh, you weren't up at half past 2 for the sake of your health. So the 4 meetings... Who were they with? What do they want? What have they asked you? You're amongst friends.
Well, one of the questions is related to the fact that can retail people participate in offerings? And you have this Rex system. I'm not going to say the company who has it, but obviously that is something that we have had in mind for quite a while, because it would make easier and much more fair to the retail investors also to participate.
So the retail people. What about the institutional people?
They got a bit quiet because of the market conditions, but I can see some awakenings going on at the moment. I don't think so I can say more, but as we all have seen in the past, that when the situation like we have had now, markets are really bad and people are really scared, but then all of a sudden US gets on going, and a lot of people are saying that it will be H1 23 when it starts the boom again. Europe delayed, but that would be another reason why we are so active in the US side.
So finally, what is the biggest threat to the business? We're going through unusual times at the moment. So I would say the previous 2 years, COVID was the threat to everything. But now we have Putin. We have a Chancellor of the Exchequer here in the UK who springs surprises as well. What would be the biggest threat to Faron?
My home country is best prepared to defend against the Russians. We have practiced that for centuries. We have armed forces up to 400,000 who have actively provided positions in our army units. I'm not worried about that. I'm more worried about that people start to lose the hope of better lives and everything that. And this threat with the nuclear weapons, it's just so stupid. I got quite a funny SMS message to my phone. It was a picture of a Northern Korean leader say that, you know, I'm not anymore the craziest leader on this planet.
Markku, thank you very much indeed. So you've got IP and you've got militia protecting the interests of Faron Pharmaceuticals. We like that. Thank you very much.